Welcome to the DVD commentary. I'm Trey Parker.
And I'm Matt Stone. This is our version of commentary, which we're calling Commentary Mini.
Yeah, because instead of doing, we're always sick of hearing, you know, people trying to fill up an hour and a half or even a half an hour of things trying to say something about their own stuff, which is really hard to do anyway. So we just decided we'd do a few minutes on each episode rather than try to waste your time.
Which is all we really have to say about each episode. Yeah. And then we would have just filled it up with a bunch of crap. Yeah. So.
But we're happy to be doing this one because I think the third season is really where South Park started to turn the corner, in our opinion, and become at least good to us. Because second season we didn't really like so much.
Yeah, looking back. Yeah. And a lot of South Park fans feel the same way, that there's a lot of funny stuff in the second season. I mean, it's better than a lot of stuff. But
we were still trying. We were just trying to figure out still what it was and how to do it. And you know, this was the first time that this season I think we really started to turn it around. And because the main reason was because we were doing the movie at the same time, and we were learning so much about structure and characters and all that during the movie that we were then able to start applying to the show. But it was tough trying to we were trying to do the movie and these shows at the same time, all the way through about. Halfway through this season, we were making the movie at the same time. We had one building here and one building about a mile away that we had to keep running back and forth between. It was tough.
Well, stuff. And this episode was inspired by Trey's trip. Trey went to Costa Rica with him and his girlfriend at the time. And he came back and he just hated it. And that's what I remember. Because I have never been to Costa Rica. Yeah. But Trey hated it and had a bunch of
funny
stories.
It was Flea from Chili Peppers that told me I had to go there. It was such a great place, and I would love it. And I went, and it was just, there were snakes everywhere. I'm not a big snake fan. And there were snakes everywhere. And it was just hot and dirty and smelly, and I didn't like it at all. So I came back all pissed off and wanting to make this show. And so basically,
pissed off at Flea, really?
Yeah, I was pissed off at Flea for lying to me.
But we got a good show out of it, so thank
you. Yeah, and then I decided, so basically Cartman, everything he says in this about Costa Rica is just me saying that. I really loved doing Cartman in the show because I was just getting out my anger.
And getting gay with kids is based on Up with People.
Yeah.
That, of course, they wouldn't let us clear for the show, but I think getting gay with kids is
I think
much
every
more
kid had to, at one point in school, do that thing in music class or whatever where you'd sang, and yet they had these kind of pre-recorded voices already there, these, like, adult voices, and you're supposed to sing with it. And but this show, too, was cool because Jennifer Aniston came in and did a voice. Apparently, her and Brad were fans, and so she wanted to come in and do something, and she was really, really nervous. I remember when she came in to do the voice, we had the script for her, and she got in the booth and, you know, in front of the mic with headphones on, and she was like visibly shaking. She was really nervous.
Maybe she was nervous around to be such big stars as us.
Yeah, I guess so. But she was just, I think, you know, it was just obvious she just hadn't done that kind of acting before. I mean, she just hadn't, you know. But once she stopped shaking, she did a great job. I think she's really funny in this.
Yeah. And my favorite part about this show is the end, where we come up with those things at the end that say, you know, this many people will die in the rainforest, kills this many people this year. Like, basically, the rainforest is cancer, like colon cancer. It's like a show about cancer.
Yeah. Just because I, like a lot of people, you know, we all grew up with, like, Earth Day and hearing all this stuff about we've got to save the rainforest, we've got to save the forest. And, you know, I had never been. And then I finally went to Costa Rica, and I was like, wait a minute, this place sucks. We don't have to save this. Fuck this place.
So it's kind of like, that's kind of that thing of most people who want to save this part of the world or do this have never been there, and if they did go there, they'd hate it.
Yeah. And all the activists we saw out here, you know, they all talk about saving the rainforest, and then they drive around in, like, SUVs and shit. It's pretty funny.
So anyway, this is our big, this episode isn't about fuck the rainforest, it's fuck the people who love the rainforest. Yeah. We talk about that all the time.
Yeah, because I guess we need the rainforest, I guess.
For something, I guess.
But so now we'll move along to the next show, because that's about all we have to say about that show. And so we'll happily move along to the second episode of this season.
Oh my god, dude, look how dirty and crappy everything is. Is this what you're looking for, Kyle?
So then we made this episode, Spontaneous Combustion. And this was still at a time we were making the South Park movie at the same time. And we basically had, one building, the building we still do South Park in. And then about a mile away, we had another entire huge building that we were doing the movie out of. And so we'd just do everything we could here for the TV show, and then we'd have to jump in our cars and go across the other building and try to work on the movie. And Paramount wasn't really happy about that. They thought we should just stop doing the show and make their movie.
Yeah, they couldn't understand why we would want to work on this show. We had a big old Paramount movie to do.
Yeah, but
But I think this show has the Cartman crucifixion in it, which was probably, I think it was one of the original things that we actually, one of the original ideas we had for the show when we pitched it before it was even on the air to Comedy Central. And it was just based on, I think, Trey, you went to Stations of the Cross one time or something?
One time, no. I used to have to go as a kid, like, to, you know, a lot of kids have had to do Stations of the Cross, and I still think it's funny to watch little kids doing Stations of the Cross, and they always have one little kid be a Jesus and go up there, and we just thought, you know, we should have the kids carry through with it and actually crucify Cartman so that he can resurrect himself.
And me being, growing up an agnostic Jew, I had never even heard of that until Trey brought it up one time in a meeting, and I just thought that was the funniest thing. And Aaron Garofino, our executive producer, is a Catholic, and so she's a practicing Catholic. She knows everything about...
Yeah, anytime we need Catholic answers in the show or to rip on Catholicism, she's the specific person.
It's almost like we rip on Catholicism more than anything else, only because Anne's around and we can find out about it.
Yeah.
If we had a Jew for an executive producer, we'd probably rip on Judaism more. So, Anne luckily is a good sport about it.
Yeah.
Even though we rip Catholics pretty good.
But this really came from, you know, obviously spontaneous combustion is something a lot of people have heard about, and it does make sense. I mean, our theory in this was that it's people that don't fart enough that basically, because farts are flammable. Kids, go ahead and try it at home. You can see.
Take
a lighter and fart, and you'll see that it will light. And so you can imagine that if you hold that in enough, you know, like a lot of women that don't, you know, don't let it rip when they should, you know, and as much as they should, they don't realize that, you know, that can build up and it can become flammable. I honestly think that could be what spontaneous combustion is.
Yeah, there's no other explanation for it, really.
Because I've seen some dudes light their farts and the fireball was big. And that was just one fart. I'm serious. I think it's totally possible. And so...
There's also a funny story for this. We tried working... Did we work in this episode about colored farts? Because Trey's dad... We should just make this all about Trey's dad and how funny Trey's dad is. Trey's dad had this idea that he wanted to patent when he was in college, which was a food additive that you would add to your food that then when you farted, they would be visible, or when you lit
they'd
them,
be colored.
They'd be colored when you farted. There'd be this colored gas
so
that
you
come
could
out of your butt.
Watch them go. So it'd be like blowing bubbles. You could sort of watch them go and chase them around and stuff like that. And he actually... wanted to do his, he's a scientist, he wanted to do his senior thesis on it.
Oh, that's a pretty fucking good idea.
Yeah, I mean, I think it
would
sell.
If you could do that, you would sell a lot of those.
The best would be giving them to your friend, like, unknowingly. That'd be the best. And then chasing their farts around.
And have them on a date, or give them to your girlfriend that you know when she farts.
But me.
Yeah, so that's basically this episode, and now we're actually not doing commentary for each show, we're doing commentary mini.
Commentary mini,
which is the new way of doing commentary, because we can't stand sitting and watching, listening to people ramble for 30 minutes that don't really have 30 minutes worth of things to say. We have about 4 minutes worth of things to say per show, and so that's about that. We're done.
Yeah.
So
we have actually 2 minutes worth of shit to say per show, but we extend it into 4, and that's commentary mini. So next episode, please. Up to his
combustion. What did he spend his time doing?
Mom, please, can we just...
So this is an episode that we like to call the Succubus.
Because that's the title of it.
Yeah, but, and it's, there's actually, Succubus is a real thing. It's like a mythology, I don't know how far back it goes, but it's like a female demon that steals the soul of men. So
we've met many in our ride.
You've come across
fame in L.A.
And this is also the episode where Matt and I for the first time did the voices of Chef's parents, which some people consider the most racist thing we've ever done on South Park.
But we don't. We consider it the most funny.
I mean, it shouldn't really. Some people were really like, well, that, you know, you can't do that. Once we did, you know, the voices of Chef's parents, it was like, why is that? Why is that so much worse than doing the voice of anyone else? I think it's them who has the problem.
It's them. Well, that was another thing where we had, that was a kind of a skit that we'd come up with before, you know, South Park was ever on the air. And it was kind of the inspiration for Chef's character, actually.
Yeah, that's right.
Was that he was this Loch Ness monster chasing, you know, UFO chasing guy. But if somehow it was really funny in a black guy's voice.
We used to always do those the voices of his parents, which weren't his parents at the time. We used to always do those voices in college.
Yeah.
And we did the whole Loch Ness monster thing forever.
And for some reason, it had to be a black guy, but it had to be about the Loch Ness monster. So that's why Chef kind of is Scottish. And he's from Scotland.
The thing about the Loch Ness monster and the Girl Scout cookies, I remember we did that in college way before we thought of South Park.
Yeah, way before, yeah. We were going to shoot a whole short film that was all about that. And so we never worked it into Chef, but it seemed like a perfect thing for Chef's parents. And it was the first time that Comedy Central let us do, you know, because originally Trey and I wanted to do the voice of Chef. Trey or I, one of us, wanted to do the voice of Chef. And we were against getting another person to play it. Although I'm glad we did, because Isaac Hayes does a great job. And that was a good decision. But originally the network didn't want us to do it because it was considered racist for a white person to do a black person's voice. So we finally got that.
I forgot that Mr. Derp is in this episode.
Oh, yeah, Mr. Derp.
Mr. Derp is my... I think Mr. Derp and Tally are right in the same category as about great, great characters.
Derp was a term we came up with when we were shooting basketball for all the dumb jokes. It was a derp joke.
Basically, if a joke, sort of like in The Animal or any of those, like, Rob Schneider movies, when someone, like, bumps into a wall or whatever, and it's like, derp!
You can just see the joke coming from 6 miles away.
Yeah. There was a lot of derp in basketball, too. We were kind of embarrassed about
it. We'd call them derp jokes.
But the other thing I remember about this show was how we decided that the way it was to sing Morning After backwards was the way to get rid of the succubus.
Right.
Which we're like, oh, okay, that'll be easy. And then actually trying to learn and sing There's Got to Be a Morning After backwards isn't easy.
And we kind of figured out after one of our sound guys, D.A. Young, he transcribed that backwards, I think. And we kind of figured out that we think that's the way Bjork writes all her songs. She writes kind of a very standard song, and then she just flips it backwards and sings it. Because there was something hauntingly catchy about the song when we did it backwards.
Yeah, everyone was walking around with that song backwards stuck in their head. It was really bizarre. So, yeah, that's about all we have to say about this show.
That's about all we can think of this show.
That's all you want to hear about this show.
Morning After, though, that's the theme song from what movie?
I know this.
It's trivia.
Poseidon Adventure.
Poseidon Adventure. That's right. That's the theme song to the Poseidon Adventure. So, leaving on that note, we'll move on to our next episode. Children, meet my new girlfriend.
So, now we're into the episodes where we were actually... finalizing, we were doing all the post on the South Park movie and trying to do these shows at the same time, and it was hell too.
That was hell.
Because I remember actually this exact episode aired. I remember being at the sound mix for the South Park movie, and people were saying that, you know, they were talking about this show that had just been on the air the night before that we had worked on.
This episode was mostly inspired by Jar Jar.
It was all inspired by Jar Jar.
Yeah.
Because it had come out a month before this or something? The new Star Wars? Yeah. And we, like everyone else in the world, hated the new Star Wars so much, and we were so excited.
And felt betrayed, really.
Yeah. And the fact that the Jar Jar thing just made us so angry that we decided to dedicate a whole show to how stupid it was. And really, I think the Jakovasaurs, which is basically the Jar Jar in this episode, I think is way less annoying than the real Jar Jar.
Right, and the whole idea behind this episode was to make that point by making the Jakovasaurs the most annoying character ever put on TV. And for that reason, some people don't like this episode very much because it just annoys them too much. But that was kind of the point.
Yeah, it was supposed to annoy. He was supposed to annoy. But I don't really see how, and I don't see how anyone can not like the episode where Cartman sings about pooping outside with a harmonica.
This is, I think both Trey and I, growing up in Colorado, did this exact thing where you pretended you were camping, but you really didn't.
Yeah, you're actually about 100 yards from your house.
Yeah, but you're camping.
But you have a fire and marshmallows, and then you know, very, very, it's at by 11 o'clock. You're back inside.
We also did this episode because I remember we did a Jar Jar inspired thing for the MTV Movie Awards that year that Star Wars came out, and we had this great idea, and we were going to do this little short with Chris Rock, and it was a great idea. This whole short we had, and MTV wouldn't let us do it because it screwed up with their advertisers that were big George Lucas, you know, supporters, because that was a big, you know, Star Wars was such a big movie. So we had to do something. You know, after getting shut down there, we had to do something about Jar Jar in the series, and that's why we did this episode.
And we ended up doing the Scientology thing for the MTV movie.
That was the next year.
Oh, that was the next
year?
Yeah,
the next year.
Oh, so we didn't do anything.
No, we didn't end up doing anything that year, I don't think.
But I remember, I think this episode came out in June. And the South Park movie came out like July 4th weekend, right?
I don't remember when the South Park.
July 4th weekend.
Oh, July 4th.
And so,
I guess because we're up against Wild Wild West.
Yeah, but I just remember that these were airing in June, and that means we were making them in June, and we were trying to get the movie. And Paramount was freaking out, going, "You guys, your air date, you know, the movie's coming out in 2 weeks, and you're still working on it." We're like, "Yeah, we got 2 whole weeks. What are you talking about?" And then this run ended. And then the movie came out right afterwards, and then we took a break, I remember.
We took a break, yeah. Finally. A well-deserved one, I have to say.
That's all I got to say about that.
Yeah. I think that's it for this this episode of Commentary Mini.
Fine, just fine.
Fine.
Right over here.
Okay, this is the fourth episode, and Matt had to go to the bathroom, so this is just Trey doing commentary. I'll be doing both me, myself, and Matt doing commentary on this episode. So this is actually one of my favorite episodes. Isn't it one of yours, Matt?
Yeah, this is my favorite episode, too. This is sweet.
Oh, Matt's back now.
All right, here I am. Did I miss anything?
Oh, yeah, this is Mr. Hatler. Actually is one of my favorite all-time episodes, just because... This is one of the most bizarre things we ever did, which we always had the habit of putting real photos into things, like that the photo of Mr. Adler's ex-girlfriend. But this time we actually took it another step and let him have flashbacks that were all shot on video. And the woman in the photo is Pam Brady, whose name you probably see come up a lot on the South Park movie and South Park shows, because she was one of the very first people that... We developed the show with, and she was a writer on the show and writer on the movie and a very, very dear, great friend of ours.
Yes, the spirit of South Park runs deep in her.
Yeah, and so it was great. We just spent a day, I remember, shooting her on swings and pretending to fly. And I love how she's flying in this, and suddenly her plane's supposed to lose control, but blood spurts all over her face, and then the plane goes down. It doesn't make any sense at all.
It's like she got shot down or something. It doesn't make any sense.
You see, some of you girls will go on to have interesting jobs and careers, but all of you pretty ones won't have to worry about that.
And this is based on an old teacher I had in school named who talked just like that. He would make you do book work. If you screwed around, you had to do book work. That's all I remember.
No, he's such a wuss.
Hey,
and this is exactly what, you know, when we were in class, when we were growing up in Colorado, you ran, like, you're like, you're like 10 years old, and you're running big, you know, circular saws and band saws and stuff.
Hurt all the time.
I don't know if they let kids do that anymore.
That's because a lot of kids, you know, up where we're from, a lot of kids were going to go on to work in garages.
Yeah, it was a vocational thing. Probably more kids were going to do that. I remember another thing we didn't put in this episode, but I just remembered it the other day. I was talking to my friend. This is just like a couple months ago. You had to learn how to use the tin snips, and he would say, to cut a piece of tin, he would say, you take your tin snips, you line it up on the tin, and you snip. That's what we all did. So we'd all walk around school making fun of him.
It was pretty sweet, because I haven't even told you this, but we were just in South Dakota. We were in Rapid City, South Dakota, and we were at the airport, and this guy recognized me. He's like, aren't you the South Park guy? I was like, yeah, and I was with Pam Brady, and he goes, you're the woman in that episode. And we all just kind of looked at him, kind of for a minute forgetting, and the dude starts going, Richard, doing her lines, and it was just amazing. We were like, you're the coolest guy ever.
Wow.
And Pam was totally flattered to be recognized.
That's great. She did a great job in this.
Yeah, I love
this
thing.
It's just so weird. In fact, like, what the hell is this right here?
We're going to stop the commentary here, but first I have to watch this live-action scene with Pam, because...
It's so weird. Why is it live-action?
Merry Christmas, Richard.
She's a fighter pilot, or what is she?
That's awesome.
She's his ex.
All right, well, that's enough commentary for this. We'll see you on the next episode.
Stop screwing around!
The bell rang. Can we go?
Oh, well, sure. Class dismissed.
Come on, you guys.
Hawkeye children, let's take our seats. We have something very...
So this is the episode called Sexual Harassment Panda, and this was definitely at the time we were at the end of our rope, because we'd been going... for like 8 months straight making the South Park movie, plus trying to do shows at the same time. We were working 7 days a week, and at this point, the movie was a couple weeks from coming out. We were stressed out about that, and it was just, I don't even know how we made a show at all.
Yeah, you're looking at just delusionary writing.
We don't remember doing these shows at all.
Yeah,
actually.
We feel very little. It's like a dream state.
Yeah, because
when you get really tired and you laugh at everything, this is what this is.
And a lot of South Park fans have said, oh, I love all the shows except for Sexual Harassment Panda. I really don't like that one. But I gotta say, I love the Sexual Harassment Panda song. It's one of my favorite things. And I know that I actually watched this episode like a year and a half ago, saying, okay, this is a lot of people's most hated episode. I'm going to watch it and see why. And I watched it, and I thought it was funny.
I think you'll notice also that Sexual Harassment Panda has exactly the same voice as Santa Claus.
But that's on purpose, because actually Sexual Harassment Panda is Santa Claus. Of course.
Uh-huh.
See, there you can see there's Sexual Harassment Panda with red underwear on. That makes him Santa Claus. But this really all came from we were trying to make a political statement here, you know, because it was at a time that, and it's still going on, but it was really bad around here where all these sexual harassment lawsuits were coming out. And, you know, it was just getting to this ridiculous phase where everyone and anyone could get sued for doing anything. And we were mostly just scared that we were going to get sued, because if you can get sued for telling a dirty joke in the workplace, well, we're pretty fucked.
We're already broke. But also, it was also the political point of, by just doing this by educating little kids about sexual harassment, you're also just sexualizing them so much.
Yeah, you're sexually harassing them.
Yeah, you're sexually harassing them by telling them all this stuff. So that was kind of the sexual harassment. Panda was like, you can put a panda suit on him, but he's still talking about stuff that kids probably shouldn't hear about. But we have a few people in our office that have a lot of goods on Trey and I, if that's what sexual harassment is. We got no money.
You know, I think this is funny. I still think it's funny. I don't think this is. I think all our worst episodes are in season two.
Yeah. Season two is definitely the.
Oh, and this. Wait, this isn't the Johnny Cochran stuff, is it? No. That was another show. No, that was Chef Aid. That was
Chef Aid.
That was season two, and that was funny.
Yeah.
You know what? Season two is funny, too.
Never mind all that stuff.
Never mind.
This is also the thing about, if you give, see, Cartman is exactly like most people, a lot of people in America, where I can sue for that? Oh, I've been wronged. I need to sue.
Yeah.
So that's what Cartman represents to us in this episode. And
that's about all we have to say about that.
I think that's it for Commentary Mini.
So please be sure to tune in for the next episode.
Exciting Commentary Mini. Pretty open
and shut. Stan Marsh, under the new sexual harassment in schools law, I am forced to find you guilty.
And we're back on Commentary Mini.
Yeah, and I remember what happened here was that these were the episodes. We had worked so hard on the movie, trying to make the movie really good, and then the movie was done, it was coming out, and we still had to make three episodes of South Park. We were still in the middle of a run. And we were just so low on ideas and so brain dead that the idea came up to do a trilogy. And basically we knew we had three episodes left, so we said, let's feature a kid in each episode and make them all happen on the same night. And that's actually, now that I think about it, a pretty sweet idea.
Yeah, I think it's a totally good idea, yeah.
So if you'll watch, this episode and the two following it all take place on the night of a meteor shower. And that's why in this episode, Cartman's left alone because his mom is going to the meteor shower party. And so this was sort of you remember when Kiss did their thing where they each did an album and it had their faces on the cover?
Yeah.
This is sort of like that.
Kind of.
That's what we were doing. Down as soon as you're done. But the thing that was cool about this was that this was the week that the South Park movie came out. And we were really pissed off that it was the same week that Wild Wild West came out, the same day that Wild Wild West came out. And of course, Wild Wild West just kicked our ass. Like, they made way more money than we did. And that was just embarrassing to us.
And it's also like, Wild Wild West was just the stupidest idea for a movie. Just a big metal spider. What the fuck
so
is that?
So poorly done. Just
and like,
so
Will Smith
done.
Is black, and that doesn't make any sense with the original Wild Wild West. It was just such a Hollywood, like, huge
turd.
Just a fucking abortion, that movie.
Yeah.
And we just knew it before it comes out, and you just knew that it was going to make a bunch of money.
Yeah.
And it was just this big juggernaut that we just couldn't
But then we
stop.
Also heard that we actually made them a ton of money, too, because what happened was the South Park movie was rated R, and so a lot of kids went and they bought tickets to Wild Wild West, and then they snuck into the South Park movie. So it made all these extra numbers for Wild Wild West.
Because remember, that was right after Columbine, and they were actually IDing kids who went into movies for about 3 months there.
Yeah.
And we actually suffer because of that.
Okay. So this is where Cartman's cat is in heat and, is looking for love. And then Shelley's boyfriend comes over and sings, I think, some great songs, too. Shelley's boyfriend, who ends up being the guy in Timmy's band later on.
Timmy's, yeah, Skylar.
Skylar, a few years later. And so you can really, this episode and the next two, you can sort of, like, if you put them into a computer, you could edit them all into like an hour and a half long thing and cut in between them, and it would all make sense. Because if you look, it's actually pretty cool. At the end of every episode, we have something from the other episodes happening. So in other words, I don't remember what they are, but
I don't remember. I remember Kenny on the street.
Yeah, we have these cool things where the other things that happened, are, you know, show up at the end of the episodes. And so, well, why don't we just move on to the second one, and then you'll be able to see what we're talking about.
Good idea. We'll see you in the next episode of Commentary Mini.
Turn! God damn it. I don't want to go to this stupid party.
Come on, Stan. You're going to have a great time.
So this was episode two of the trilogy, which we call the Meteor Shower Trilogy. And while Cartman is being babysitted by Shelley in the previous episode, a lot of people in town, including his mother, are driving to the meteor shower party at Mr. Mackey's house. And that's where now this episode, which is sort of the Stan-featured episode, Stan's got to go to the party and hang out with the sort of nerdy kids at the party.
In the basement, because all the parents are upstairs getting drunk.
Yeah.
Which is exactly what I will do when I have kids, is I'll go to my friends and I will party and get all fucked up, and I will lock my kids in the basement with some stale pretzels.
Absolutely locked. And this is the episode that is, in a lot of ways, the birth of Butters, the character Butters, because although we've seen him before and I think we've heard a line or two from him before, this is really where we needed to make him into a character. And it's funny because his voice is a little different, just like all the characters, his voice is a little different starting here because Matt's just sort of figuring it out.
I remember because we came up with this because Mr. Butters is what we call our animation director, Eric Stow. And on the movie, when we were working on the movie, just locked in the movie office for late hours, we started making fun of him because he is right here. That's what he sounds like when he talks. He just is a little wuss. And so we started making fun of his voice, and then out of that was like, hey, maybe we should just attach that to Butters and make a real character out of that.
Yeah.
So it really came out of making fun of Eric.
And then Butters over the years has evolved and evolved into probably definitely one of my top three favorite characters. And he became, and actually he then later became Professor Chaos, the bringer of all destruction and doom. And that little kid next to him, Dougie, became his partner in evil, General Disarray.
Yes.
And he doesn't really... He's in this episode. General Disarray, that little Dougie kid, is in this episode, and then not again until that...
For like 3 years.
Yeah, he disappeared for 3 years. Great party, Mr. Mack. Because we really thought our classic nerdy character we had was Pip, but then really after this episode, we realized Butters was
Butters is a better character. Oh, I'll pass. I don't. And then the other story, and this is where Stan's dad and Kyle's dad have a little homosexual experience.
But they just watch each other jack off, and so it arises. Does watching a friend jack off make you gay? Which we've learned, no, it certainly doesn't.
Somebody told us that.
So we've been told it's fine.
And then this episode also, it ends with a homage to our brothers in the Branch Davidians who were slaughtered by the horrible U.S. government.
Fallen brothers in Waco.
Were slaughtered by the U.S. government in the Waco disaster.
Yeah, there was like some HBO documentary right around this time that came out about Waco, and we saw it and we're like, wow, boy, they really, really fucked that up. And
yeah.
So we did our own version of what happened. Really, it's just sort of exactly what happened in Waco at the end of this. And
pretty much, including the Cher. Didn't they play Cher here?
Yeah, they play Cher to try to drive people out, and they actually did that in Waco.
Yeah, well, they do that all the time. They did that with like Noriega, and apparently they're doing that in Iraq now too. Using heavy metal.
I'd have shot myself. There's no question about it.
But I don't think they use Cher, do they? I don't know.
And then we do this Cher parody at the end of this show, and that's Pam Brady again doing the voice of Cher.
Oh, Mr. Mackey, you nut.
Hell, we should get
And
in.
So, just like in the other one, you see at the end of this, I don't remember what it is again. I think it's something to do with Skylar being chased by cats or something, but it's at the end of this episode that references the episode before this. And then this hurls us, of course, into the third episode of the trilogy.
Chilling conclusion.
Which is the grand finale of it all, okay, Jewbilee, which we'll go on to now.
On Commentary Mini.
You know what our mission is, little first grade kid?
Hold still, Ike. We have to get you dressed.
And now the classic finale of the trilogy, a show called Jewbilee, which is honestly one of our favorite episodes of all time.
Yeah, we just had to, on our 100th episode, Hollywood Reporter ran a big thing. We had to name our top 10 episodes, and this was in my top one or two. This episode is just so awesome because it's just so weird.
And it's mostly because, as we've said before, that now, so this was the last episode of this particular run of shows. And so We had been working on the movie tirelessly. The movie came out. It was doing well, but we still had to do three more episodes, and this was the last one we had to do, and we were literally crawling around on the floor trying to finish a show. But we were also all basically already on vacation in our minds. We all knew where we were going. I was going down to Hawaii, and we were already there in our minds because we just so desperately had to get out of these offices. And so we really kind of had this thing in the back of our minds like, all right, you know what? We did really good job on the movie. We've had some good shows. Fuck it. Let's just do an episode.
Whatever it is.
Who cares? You know, usually we really care about how good the shows are. And this time we were like, fuck it. Who cares? Just make it dumb and weird. And it ended up being one of the best, our favorite shows.
And look at Jew Scouts. It starts with the Jew Scouts. How dumb can you get?
Which really taught us a very important lesson. I think this show actually really helped us too with the shows to come and made South Park better eventually, which is we just realized, don't sit around a table and figure out your plot for very long. Just be stupid and
have fun.
And have fun, and it'll come out. Or it could also be that we're the only ones that think this episode's sweet.
Yeah, I love this episode.
But I think that the very best thing about this episode is Moses and the fact that it's that thing from Tron. And when Moses says no cake for the impurity, I think, and talks about popcorn necklaces and macaroni pictures, I don't know. It all makes perfect sense to me.
In a way that when you're tripping on acid, some things just make sense. When you're really, really tired and you've been working for a year straight, no cake for the impurity, it just makes perfect sense.
Yeah, it was as if we were all tripping on acid because we just had so little sleep and so little brain power left. It was like being drugged up.
And you'll notice in this episode, the B story is about the what are they called? Squirts?
Yeah, squirts.
With the squirts, then they have to go... with the squirt master, and then they get taken by the bear, but the squirt master is the ticket guy from the South Park movie.
Yeah.
This guy talks like that.
I don't know. Does he look the same? He talks the same.
Yeah, I think he looks the same. Yeah.
Yeah.
I always thought he was the same guy. Just a little more cross pollination from South Park's franchise empire.
Yes, genius. Absolute genius. But it was really funny because I remember, especially at the end of this, you know, because we sort of do the shows. We sort of write them somewhat in order, where we know the beginning first and the middle, and then by Monday and Tuesday we're scrambling trying to figure out how to end it. And I remember trying to figure out how to end this one, and we're just like, fuck it, dude. And it's so retarded and stupid the way this show ends, but it just makes perfect sense.
The conk of blind faith.
And now I realize it's definitely well more thought out than The Matrix Reloaded or a lot of the summer movies that have come out this summer, actually.
Or Triple X.
Yeah. It's still, we spent, so little time
we
worrying about the plot.
We shit this out of our ass.
Yeah, and it's still better than those movies. And I think people's voices change all the time, too. And
doesn't make
all the, like, sometimes I'm one of the elders, that then Matt, and then, like, next shot, he's the elder. It's pretty sweet.
It's really just terribly put
but
together.
But what happened was we finished this show. We were like, fuck it. We got it out. And we ended up really loving it. And then we had our first break in like 2.5 years. And we all went away for a month. And then about a month after that, we started work on the next run of shows, which starts now.
We're here live at the Cozy 102.1.
So we had all had a big, nice break off from the movie and went our separate ways and got our first break in a long time, and we had to come back and start working on a new show, which was going to be the first episode of the next season was going to be Halloween. And so I remember this episode being one of the most difficult we ever did, because I think it was just because we were gone for a while and on our heads were in a different place, and then it just took forever to try to get back into the groove of things.
We were still on vacation.
Yeah. But I love this episode, actually, because this is where we first really tried a different style of animation. We tried to do a Hanna-Barbera-looking Scooby-Doo style of animation and see if we could do it, you know, in our same program and do all the same things we do South Park with, but make it look like Hanna-Barbera. And I think they did a great job with all the Korn guys just suddenly look like Hanna-Barbera in our world. It's pretty cool.
Yeah, and this is the Korn approached, or through, you know, some people work for us, and through Korn's management company, they kind of approached us because their new album was coming out, and they said, hey, we'd love to have our, you know, you can premiere our first single on South Park, and we'd never really into that kind of, like, too cheesy of a promotion thing. But then we started thinking about how great it would be to just do an entire episode with them, you know, and make them, like, this kind of, like,
Well, because to do like the Harlem mystery. When the Harlem Globetrotters would come on Scooby Doo, that was the whole idea, was do that with Korn.
In this, do them in our in this, you know, recast Korn in this totally like Scooby Doo kind of thing.
Super cheesy role.
Yeah.
And I remember they were all super cool and they were into it and they all did a good job. And then except for that dude,
the bass player was kind of bummed out.
He was bummed out because we made him Velma, and like they did a version of him where he like had glasses and he does have glasses.
Yeah, yeah.
But
like
they did a version where they really made him look kind of feminine and like Velma and really fat, and he's like, I'm not fat and I don't wear glasses, and he was all pissed off and everything. And but the other guys laughed at him enough that they made him stick with it.
Yeah, and I think they did a great job. Their voices and stuff, you know, I think they did a really good job getting into it.
And of course, there's nothing better than Niblet.
Yeah, Niblet, the best character that's been in 7 seconds of Southward. Like, the best 7 second character in all of Southward.
He's another Tally. We need sort of a Moses Tally Niblet special.
Yeah.
That's what we got to do next.
Because Niblet just is so underutilized in South Park. It's a great.
And I just love spooky pirate ghosts. They always work.
And the argument of whether it was pirate ghosts or ghost pirates was really an argument that we had in the writer's room.
Yeah, Kyle McCullough, one of the writers, was like, they're not pirate ghosts, they're ghost pirates. And they actually, and Matt argued with him because Kyle and Matt always argue in things. And they actually sat there and argued about whether it was a pirate ghost or a ghost pirate. And then, of course, that just went into the show. But.
Because it matters, because if there were pirates that died, then they were ghost pirates. And if they were ghosts first, just people that died and then became pirates, then they'd be pirate ghosts. And so we just put that argument in the show because it is so retarded.
So, so we're super proud of that episode, and that's why we're not going to talk a whole much more about it. We're
just let you watch it and enjoy it.
Move on to the next thing.
And commentary mini. With my little eyes, something that begins with a letter.
So this is the episode called Chinpokomon. And Chinpoko means penis in Japanese. So Chinpokomon is a penis monster.
Right.
Which of course is all based on the Pokemon stuff, which at the time was at its sort of peak of popularity. I
see. It was scary huge how big it was. It was
like, and we knew how huge it was, and so we said, oh, well, let's get it. We got an episode, and we all the writers sort of sat in the room and watched a Pokemon episode, and we all just were amazed at just how nothing happened.
Nothing happened, and it was all about, the plot was all about, you've got to collect the Pokemon.
Yeah.
Like the whole point of the show was collect all the Pokemon you could.
Yeah.
And then of course kids went out and bought all the Pokemon you could. It was just, it's the most genius thing ever, actually.
Yeah.
If you want to steal money from kids.
And so what's cool about this episode too is that it stars the voice of my longtime friend Junichi Nishimura, who I met in college when I was studying Japanese and he was studying English. And he works on South Park now, but he was around, so we had him be the emperor.
Emperor Hirohito.
Yeah. And then there's a big part of this show where the emperor Hirohito has a sidekick named Mr. who has the penis is so smooth, and he always talks about this small penis. And that actually was a real person that when we went out with Junichi was working in Beijing for a while, and Matt and I, this was years ago, went out to visit him, and his boss's
name was... In the
winter,
for some reason, we went to Beijing in the winter.
New Year's Eve.
Yeah.
And his boss's name was Mr. And we were out at a bar one night, and he was saying, oh, American penis so big. And we were just like, yeah, okay, cool. And he was like, my penis is me. And he was like, no, look, my penis, Fia penis is me. And he, like, actually had Matt touch his penis. And and it really was.
Yeah, it was teeny. It was teeny.
He wasn't
so
lying.
So that's not bullshit about the Japanese. They have small penises. But then it also is such a, it is such a thing that, like, the Japanese use it as a weapon in this show, where every time the Americans, you know, start asking them questions about what the hell are you doing, they go, hey, your penis is so big. And, of course, if you say that to a man, they'll immediately back off and they'll be like, yeah, that's right. I do have a big penis. And I think that's what Japanese do, basically, to Americans. Is they just feed into that.
And the basic idea of the show, you know, the whole Pokemon thing was going on. We're like, this has to be, you know, it's all Japanese, all the Pokemon stuff. So we're like, this has to be some kind of plot to take Pearl Harbor again, because you know they want it. I mean, you go down there. Go down to Oahu, and they're trying to take it over just in number.
Yeah, they're just trying to buy Oahu in Hawaii now.
But it's really
scoping it out.
It's pretty genius. If the Japanese did what we did in this show and did somehow put some chips in their thing, they would have taken over the world by now. They probably will.
Yeah, they probably will. And this is
I think that's it for this episode.
Yeah. Okay, well, let's
so we'll go on to the next one.
We don't want to take any more time from the other episodes of Commentary Mini.
What's a Chinpokomon?
Look, Eric, Mommy got you a present.
The episode, this episode, was about homeschooled kids because we have a friend of ours, George Brandon, who puts his kids in homeschool. What?
Can't say real names.
We can say George. He wants to us. Look,
I got you. Yeah, I guess so. Fonics.
What the hell is hooked on monkey phonics?
It's a new way to learn how to read and spell, and it comes with everything you need to help win that spelling bee.
What?
It says we just put the cassette into a tape player.
Welcome to Hooked on Monkey Phonics, level one.
This episode was kind of about...
And about this little... We saw one of those spelling bee things where there's a little girl that kept spelling words into her hand. And all the kids in spelling bees, in like the championships of spelling bees, just look like they get beat down by their parents all the time. I think they all get abused.
There was one little girl who used to, she would talk, and we do it in this episode, where she would say the letters into her hand and then say it into the mic on the spelling bee. They started showing it on ESPN a couple of years ago.
And it was funny, those kids are all super nerdy, and it's kind of like, you know, that it's like, even if you win the spelling bee, if you become champion of spelling bee, it's like, well, congratulations, you're a big dork. Like, you know, you're just going to go get your ass kicked by all the other kids in school for winning a spelling bee.
And every kid that won it, you know, every kid that wins it is always homeschooled.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And they have no, you know, and they're just big nerds that are going to grow up to be adult nerds.
And this episode really does, it actually does, in a kind of philosophical way, distill what is the essence of South Park to Trey and I, which is when you see the kids, that it basically boils down to the essence of most people, when they think of kids, think about them as innocent and they're just, you know, run around and they're peaceful and they're like flowers and they're just full of peace and harmony in their hearts. And we just view kids as just evil little bastards. And this episode, I think, more clearly defines that than anything, that the kids around town just prey upon the weak. And that's what our boys do to the homeschool kids. They see them as weak.
Any guy we've talked to remembers being a kid. It's all about it being a chimp, basically, and like beating up the ones, weeding out the weak, and, you know, and that's what it's all about.
Yeah, it really is. And so then we did a whole play on that with the parents, or kind of the same way with the homeschool parents. Yeah.
Mark, your word is conscientious.
What the fuck does that mean?
Conscientious. May I have the definition, please?
Closely attentive to details. Careful.
Conscientious. Could you use it in a sentence, please?
Mary's analysis of the spreadsheet was conscientious.
Conscientious. C-O-N-S-C-I-E-N-T-I-O-U-S.
Holy crap!
Way to go, Mark! All right!
Okay, our next contestant is Eric Cartman. All right, Eric, here is your word. Chair. Chair.
Try to think of what else is in this episode. There's the monkey. That's funny.
The big thing about this episode that's funny, too, is that we've come up with this episode about three different times.
Yeah.
And like a year after this, we were in a writer's meeting and somebody brought up the idea of, you know, what about homeschool kids and how they're always really nerdy? And because the whole thing, the reason against homeschooling is that a kid needs to learn not just, you know, history and math, but they need to learn social skills. And you need to be on a playground getting your ass kicked by a bunch of kids to learn that. And so someone was like, you know, we should do something where the homeschool kids, and they're really nerdy and they've got it. And we're like, that's great. And we actually spent like a whole afternoon structuring it out. And I'm like, wow, this sounds familiar. I think maybe The Simpsons did it. And we're like, we always say, oh, The Simpsons probably did it. And then we come to find out, no, actually, we did this a year ago. And then
we did it again. About 6 months ago, we came up with this whole episode
that
we talked about for 2 hours. We're like, fuck, that's that episode again.
Yeah. So it's such a good idea. We keep coming up with it over and over. I'm sure at some point we'll do it again. We'll forget.
But enough about this episode. Let's move on.
You don't want to hear next great episode of South Park. Let's go on. So this is one of the, I think this is the first time we ever did a cold open on the show, which means we didn't do credits beforehand. And that's because we really thought of this as a different show. This was Starvin' Marvin in Space. This wasn't South Park.
Yeah, this is the first episode of Starvin' Marvin in Space.
And it was because, you know, Thanksgiving time was coming around again, and, you know, Starvin' Marvin was such a favorite with people that we wanted to give back to everyone another Starvin' Marvin thing. And we thought, well, of course, an Ethiopian in space is the way to go.
We also got to rekindle Sally Struthers
in
her in a great role in this this episode.
And of course, the people of Marklar, who just sort of randomly use Marklar for every other word. But it's really interesting because if you speak Marklar like they all do at the end, you understand exactly what they're saying.
Yeah.
Which just shows, you know, that the English language kind of is a lot overdone, because you can sort of, every other word, if you replace with Marklar, people pretty much know what
you're saying. If you know what kind of is going on, you can kind of figure out what they're being said.
And so we wanted to do a whole thing with Pat Robertson. Pat Robertson's always on TV talking about some thing they're building or some, yeah, how they need money for this and that and the other. And he's always got that smug little laugh that no matter what, you know, even, yeah, it's like, what we've got to do. And it's just like, you just want to slap.
And also, it was about this time that we found out that the 700 Club, I never knew what 700 Club, like what that meant or what that stood for.
No, Marvin, in God's language.
So to be a part of the 700 Club, you have to send in like $54 or something a month, and then you're part of the 700 Club because you spent. And they have a 2500 Club and a 5000 Club.
People are doomed to eternal hellfire.
It's kind of like Pokemon in a way. It's kind of like just give.
700 Club!
just get it. Just
get to
money.
Get it. You get to get it.
What a great fucking
blessing
idea.
From God!
So obviously, yeah, Pat Robertson has to follow Starvin Marvin out into space. So that's my favorite part of the show, is when Pat Robertson's trying to get the stuff for the space cruiser, yeah, the Tiberian Junker.
Yeah, we need a Tiberian Junker.
This episode's great because it just ticks everything to just another level.
Yeah.
Like, what the fuck? Because this doesn't have anything to do with South Park or our boys or, you know, it's like.
I remember actually one time it was pretty sweet. We were in New York. Remember, we were doing that photo shoot for what's her name? And someone was putting us in costumes and they were like, so you guys make South Park? And we were like, yeah. And she goes, I've actually never seen that. And we're like, and I was like, oh, that's cool. And she was like, but there's this other cartoon on the air that's really funny. It's about this little Ethiopian kid, and he flies around in a spaceship, and he tries to kill Sally Struthers. Have you seen that cartoon? And she thought that it was a whole cartoon that was that every week, was a little Ethiopian kid in a spaceship flying around. Which would be. We really should have just made this a spin-off show.
God damn it, sorry. There's some 3D animation right
there.
Yeah,
look at that. That might have been our first 3D titles. Look at that, a whole movie dissolved, too.
Wow, we spent some money on that.
Yeah, see, we learned a lot from the movie. And we really started.
It's a money shot right there.
Can I help you?
So anyway, we'll now be moving on to the next episode in micro commentary.
you, and you.
Ready? 1, 2, 3, 4.
So basically what happened was, during that last episode, I think right after we had finished all the dialogue, was when Mary Kay, who was the woman that did almost all the female voices in the show, killed herself. And that was weak.
Very sad. That was a sad day at South Park.
That was weak. And I remember that we basically still had like 2 or 3 shows to do. And so you'll see that in this episode that we had to come up with on the fly, because we had to... Basically, you know, we don't have any lead time. We do the shows right as they go on the air. So we had to do shows that didn't involve any of our female characters.
Because we obviously didn't want to feel like auditioning people, you know.
Yeah, right away.
Or right away. Or it felt kind of somehow, you know, just kind of lame to do. But nonetheless, we had to come up with some shows to go on the air. So there's
so
no female characters in the next
couple. Sit down and scramble
episodes
on a Wednesday before the Wednesday that the show is going to air and say, okay, we got to come up with shows where we don't have to record any female dialogue. And so the first one we came up with was this, The Red Badge of Gayness, which is all about those Civil War reenactments everybody does.
Yep.
And they didn't really do any in Colorado because there was no Civil War battlefields there. But I remember as a kid I'd seen some in like Tennessee or Kentucky.
Right, yep.
And they're always amazing. I mean, people do take them very, very seriously. It's
people get really
amazing
into them. They only use the cloth, you know, that they make their uniforms and like only the cloth of the time and using only the stitching of the time. People get really, really into it. I can't really see myself getting that into Civil War reenactments.
Yeah. And this also has s'more flavored schnapps in it, which I can just taste immediately when I hear that. Like, I think it's a great idea.
It's such a good idea. Someone hasn't done it?
Well, if they could do... It's tough because you got to get the flavor of graham crackers, marshmallow, chocolate, and kind of the smoky, woodsy flavor,
yeah,
too. I think that's the part they probably can't get.
Char and ants on it. The great part about this episode is the Cartman letters.
Yeah.
Chinabin.
And what's funny
those
is
ones,
that as Cartman's voice has changed over the years, this was another show that really... From this show on, his voice was always different, too, because once I started doing his voice with that Southern accent, I could never fully drop it. So he always, from this moment on, always had this kind of Southern accent when he chose to have it. He only does it on certain words, but
I think it was also a little bit inspired by that dumb, big, stupid, dumb movie, Gettysburg.
Yeah. Boy, was that bad.
God, we thought that was going to be so good. We went and saw
it 4 hours.
The beards
look worse than the beards on this show.
That's the worst. Yeah.
But it should be interesting because basically as you go through, I'm sure in these next few episodes there's a woman here or there, but we basically just had to grab whoever was in the office and have them do a female voice while we figured out, you know, what we were going to do. Would there be a future? Because Mary Kay was so awesome at doing, all these voices. She was all these characters. We could just bring in this one woman and have her do all these things. And we ended up having to replace her with about 3 different people to do all the things that she was able to do.
Yeah.
But enough about this show. I think we should move right along.
Seems like it's about time to move on. Move on to the next commentary mini.
Dude, what are we going to do for New Year's Eve? It has to be awesome.
I know. It's probably going to be the
So this was the episode we did for the new millennium. It was from 1999 to 2000 New Year's. And I remember Comedy Central just wanted a millennium show because it was something everybody was doing. Everyone
yeah,
had
everyone was
the millennium episode of this and that and the other. And so really our season was over. It ended with that Christmas special. But then I don't remember. Did we come back in January and make this?
We made it before we left.
That's weird that we actually did a show ahead of time.
Yeah, I think we left. But everyone, it was like no one cared because we were so sure Y2K was going to hit and then, all the computers were going to stop and it was going to be World War III. So we didn't care.
But I remember, because on New Year's Eve, I was in Times Square.
Yep.
Where were you?
In Colorado. I was in Steamboat Springs.
Oh.
Snowboarding. I thought that would be the perfect place to hang out for the millennium.
Perfect place to die.
Perfect place for World War III. It'd be Steamboat Springs, Colorado. Dude,
but yeah, this is where Carmen gets his period. And
this is also an episode where we see God.
Yeah, this is the first time we knew that Jesus was looked like Jesus and talked like Jesus, but we had to have. We talked a long time. What should God look like? Should he be the sort of grandfather figure we always see, or like a
Vishnu kind of thing? Or like.
And then we ended up making it a sort of like a midget hippopotamus lizard thing.
Cat hippopotamus thing.
Yeah. Which is kind of like, why not?
Yeah.
I mean,
every religion has their own version of God, and none of them really makes sense.
Because you would hope that God would be that cool, that, like, if he can take any form, that he'd do something that would just fuck with your head really bad, and do, like, midget hippopotamus or something.
You know, sweet too, then he shows up in Las Vegas, right?
Yeah.
Look at that shot with those TV cameras. Goddamn those TV cameras. If you look at the TV cameras in that shot, they're, like, from 1930.
That's probably the and we just caught that about
that?
4 months ago when we were doing the show.
The fuck are those
we
TV cameras?
We still had these TV cameras, and we never,
The fuck are those?
And so, yeah, this is Jesus, sort of the same thing as Groundhog's Day, basically.
Yeah. Why did Jesus pick Las Vegas to come back to?
Because he has to put on a huge show.
Oh, that's right.
He feels like people don't care anymore, and so now he's got to put on a huge show. So he gets, what's his name? The old rock star, Rod Stewart.
Oh, Rod Stewart, that's right.
He gets Rod Stewart to come out, and he poops his pants.
Oh, that's right. Poops his pants.
And I can't remember. I mean, I remember we had to do this episode, and then I guess we had to do it. It was really weird the way the season worked out this time. We sort of owed shows or something like that.
I don't remember at all.
So what happens at the
millennium?
The season should have just ended with the Christmas show.
And there's that address. The address on the show of Jesus is 80122, which I think is the zip code in Colorado, probably where you live.
No, mine's 80465.
Mine was 80120. It's probably where Eric's is. Some smarty. Has a little trivia for you.
But what I'm really interested in is there's still one show left in this run, and I don't know what it possibly could be, because we basically did all this. We did the Christmas show. We did a New Year's show.
And that should have been the end.
And yet they're saying there's one more show left in this DVD season. And
I don't know about you, but I can't
to see
wait
what
to find
it is.
Out.
I think we should just move right on to it.
Hello? Dude, did you get your period?
Saturday, Pox presents the musical event of the new millennium. You'll remember playing the recorder in
elementary
school.
We just saw that the slate, that it's the brown noise, is the was the last show of this run, and that seems really bizarre. I guess what we did was we did like a run of 6 leading up to Christmas, and then we did millennium in this as a little 2-week run in January.
I guess.
I think Comedy Central just sort of took them as they came at that point, and we were just trying to get things done. But I'm actually pretty stoked because this is one of my favorite episodes. Not so much in execution, but purely in wrongness.
Yeah.
This is one of the most fucked up things we've ever done. In fact, Danny DeVito told us that this was his favorite episode because it's just the most fucked up thing. The fact that Mr. Garrison has to deal with the fact that his father never molested him as a child. And he feels that, you know, other kids were molested, and so their parents were obviously attracted to him, and why wasn't I attractive? What was wrong with me? And so Garrison spends a lot of time in this episode trying to get his father to molest him, and it never really works.
Like, if he gets his father to molest him, then everything will be okay. It's like the reverse after-school special from hell. And then the other thing in this is the concept of the brown noise, which I remember we were doing something with the Dust Brothers, the producers, one time, and they're the ones who told us that they were actually researching this thing called the brown noise, which is this. I mean, I've heard it in other places, some kind of
World War II
legend. Yeah, but I mean, that it actually, that the French or the Germans, I don't remember which side, were trying to come up with this noise. Apparently, there is a certain frequency that if it's hit for long enough, it just causes your bowels to involuntarily just let loose, and you shit your pants. And they were trying to figure out what that frequency was, or they knew the frequency, and they were trying to figure out how to blast it on loudspeakers across the front lines to make the enemy shit themselves. And that's a true story. So, of course, when we heard that, we were intrigued.
Yeah. Any noise that can make you crap your pants is great.
Yeah, so we thought, maybe that's what happens in this.
But this really brings us to the end of this, and I'm a little sad because I've had such a great time, and I wish there was a lot more episodes for us to sit here and commentary over, and I'm sure that you wish you could hear us talk a lot longer.
Yeah.
But unfortunately, there's just not more shows until I guess they do season 4.
So if you liked mini commentary, let us know on the website or
because
get in touch with us.
It was our idea that basically. Because I don't like listening to people ramble and ramble and ramble and ramble and go on and on and on and ramble and ramble and just try to fill up time by going on and on and on and rambling and just going on and rambling just to try to fill up time.
Which is what you have to do when you have 22 minutes of show.
I mean, we honestly just don't have 22 minutes of worth of things to say about each episode. So, you know, we said let's just do a couple minutes per episode. And
the DVD company wanted us to just do commentary on one or two episodes.
Right, and even that.
And that's just kind of
stupid. We'd rather do, you know, all in all, we've done several minutes.
We've done probably 30 minutes altogether if you added up everything and put a little space in between each one.
And I think you did a great job, Matt.
Yeah, thanks. And Trey, I think you did a great job.
I think the whole thing, I wish it didn't have to end.
Well, I think for season 3, Trey deserves the best commentary mini between me and Trey.
Yep.
And maybe
we should both be nominated and I should win.
And I think Trey should win. I got second place. And maybe on season 4, if everyone liked commentary mini, they can write in and maybe I'll win the next one.
And we'll see you on season 4. And everyone, just throw away your season 2 DVDs because I don't like those shows. Thanks, everyone.
See you later.